when I'm not working, a lot of my creativity is going into what could be done to show people that their money would be well spent, it would make a difference, and, you know, try and make sure that World Health gets more priority.
Then you can save lives.
That's what it's all about.
I spoke with Microsoft co-founder Bill Gates in 2001, a year after the creation of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. 16 years later, that foundation is still saving lives.
In a big way, thanks in part to the foundation's work, global childhood mortality. Listen to this figure, has dropped by more than 55% since 1990. 89% of the world's population is now vaccinated, and the proportion of people living in extreme poverty has dropped to just 9% in 2016. That's down from 35% in 1990.
But in a new report, Bill and Melinda Gates warn that future progress is in jeopardy. They wrote there is, quote, more doubt than usual about the world's commitment to development. They add development deserves our attention.
Bill Gates is the co-chair and trustee of the foundation. He joins us back right here in Studio 57. Good morning.
Good morning.
So let's just understand exactly what you mean, because, I mean, the kinds of problems you're attacking, and you're making a dent, but the size of government enables you to take a large thing, to take it to scale. And without government doing that, you face reverses.
That's right. The 1% of the U.S. budget that goes towards this is over five times what we spend. And so by partnering with the U.S. government and making sure the money's very well spent, the potential is huge, but if that got cut back, for example, we show up, they cut the HIV spending by 10%, 5 million additional people would die between now and 2030.
And as you've said, HIV is one of the successes in global health.
You know, it's amazing that the drugs are getting out to everyone, the costs have come down, and that gives us a chance when we invent a vaccine to really bring that disease down to zero.
A quick scorecard, polio. Where do we stand on polio?
We're close. We've got some cases in Pakistan and Afghanistan.
But isolated.
It's isolated. We're down to less than 50 cases a year. We've got Syria and Pakistan, Afghanistan, and with any luck, those will be the last cases in the next year.
Mm. We saw President Barack Obama standing behind the goalkeeper's podium earlier this week. Which I thought was very exciting, just to see that it brings attention to goalkeepers, because I think what you all do is so important. There are 17 different goals. If you could lay out the top three in no particular order, Bill, what are you most excited about?
Well, they do kind of go together. They've got poverty, education, gender, health. Health is the one that we've worked in the most, but you know, we need to get kids so that they're fully developed, so that they have the right nutrition, so they can go to school. We need progress on gender so that you've got girls in those schools and they're contributing equally. And so the first six are the really fundamental ones.
And the goal is 2030, is it not?
That's right.
We're gonna do this 2030.
All the 193 countries, which is pretty phenomenal, agreed in 2015 that this would be the focus between now and 2030. This would be the report card on how are we taking care of each other. And most people don't realize the progress we're making, but we're also highlighting that that progress is at risk if the kind of generosity and research, innovation, if we're not still focused on the world at large.
And what concerns you most about the direction this country is moving in?
Well, if you had a huge turn inwards, and you said, okay, we don't care that the HIV epidemic goes and explodes in Africa, we don't care that they have good health care there, you know, a pandemic can start there and go and spread to the world. So the good news about the increased stability in education and health, all of that could go into reverse if we're too self-centered.
Do you worry about policies on immigration and because of the contribution, especially in technology, immigrants have made?
Well, I think bad immigration policies are both unjust and unwise economically. We've benefited by having very talented people want to come to the United States. Many other countries are very envious that a lot of their top people see the freedom and the quality of the academics here, and so that's part of the reason why our universities and companies are so strong. So I think it'd be a mistake from an economic point of view. Even worse, though, is how you treat people, and including those already here.
And let me ask you about DACA, because Brad Smith, the president of Microsoft, made some headlines when he said that DACA, in his opinion, was more important right now to handle than even tax reform. Do you agree with that?
Oh, absolutely. I'm very proud of the clear response that the Microsoft provided there. It's great. We shouldn't let those 800,000 have that uncertainty or do anything against them, and that should be the top priority for any legislative agenda.
You still spend part of your time at Microsoft looking at the future, trying to think about how the company can be involved in the future. Give us a sense of what you think is the most important developments. Obviously, artificial intelligence, obviously, augmented reality, obviously, virtual reality. What else?
Well, artificial intelligence has a frontier, which is humans can read and understand things. You can read a textbook and know something about, say, biology. Computer software cannot do that today. It can do a search and find a word for you in that book, but it can't go out and gain knowledge and become an expert. And all the AI companies, including the universities, we're working on teaching the computer to read. It can see, it can listen, but it really can't read in any meaningful sense. And that's where seeing your different emails and helping you get organized, knowing what would be important to you, what I sometimes call your alter ego in software. If we can't read, we can't do that. So that's kind of the next big frontier.
And when will that be?
Well, I'm optimistic. It's something Microsoft has made a priority, maybe in 5 years.
What were you thinking when you did ctrl-alt-delete? Because you know that's such a big pain. And you even said the other day that if you could change it, you wish you had done one button.
Well, yeah, it's a little tricky to tell people that these three strange keys, do something special on your computer. and between us and IBM, that one wasn't as user-friendly as it should be. So we feel bad about that.
And of course, you did okay. You did all right.
I pointed out an article by David Brooks this morning in the New York Times, the column. There is some talk about the power of tech companies today. and part of the rising populism that may exist here may lead to greater scrutiny of these huge tech companies, including antitrust questions. You've been through that at Microsoft.
That's right. When you have companies that are super successful, very profitable, very mainstream, and at least in the near term, they look like they're not subject to much competition, and everybody starts to think about that, as particularly now where the whole idea of how you read the news is being shaped, or a lot of how you buy things are being so shaped by these tech giants. So the scrutiny makes sense. I hope that it's smart scrutiny. Sometimes it's just, going and trying to undermine. But here, these are important platforms, and even Europe's going to look perhaps even tougher at these companies. Than the United States did. And it's a little bit of a repeat of what Microsoft went through.
Could I go back to your philanthropy work for just a second?
Sure.
You and Melinda have talked about this, that you're going to donate most of your funds to charity. You have three children. Did you run it by the kids before you all made that decision? Hey, Mom and Dad, wait a second.
Yeah, as the kids have grown up, we talk more about it.
Yeah.
Our oldest is 21 now, and so she has a very clear picture of how committed we are to support her, and yet still have most of the funds going towards the cause of the foundation. So they're very nice. They've gone with us on a trip.
Yeah, she was at the convention. She was at the conference, was she?
That's right.
Yeah.
She sat there and loved to see President Obama there.
But there's so much you all could do with your money, but you've decided to do this, and I think that that's very commendable. This is not a photo op for the two of you.
Right, we have two things that we're focused on. One, in the United States, is improving education. We both had amazing educations here. We were very lucky. And then the other is this global health work. And because you need to get serious and specialized, we're going to stick to those two things for the rest of our lives.
But have you found it's harder to do education? It's a bigger challenge than doing global health?
It is, amazingly.
Yeah.
The global health, we say that we've cut childhood death in half. I have no equivalent figure.
Exactly.
Where
math
scores have doubled or twice as many low-income kids going to college. We're working on that, and we're not daunted by the fact that it's been hard. This is a super important thing for the country, both for individuals and for the overall strength of the country.
Bill and Melinda Gates, changing the world again. You said in the beginning, a computer in every house. You've done that, and now you're doing other things. Congrats to you both.
Thank you. Great to see you.